Yes, stand away and don't walk away.
I would like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land and waters that we gather on tonight. May we all respect that we are on old land, recently colonised, that is trying to find its space. I would like to open up the conversation tonight to you, the audience, but firstly, I'd like to introduce our guests and to unpack some essential framework for the direction that our conversation is to take. Collections of Consequences with Daniel Boyd and Michael Aird is a conversation that focuses on Daniel's artwork, decommissioned skull boxes, National History Museum, London, 2017. On show here until the 23rd of February. No doubt all of you have seen the exhibition just now or recently. This most powerful and truthful exhibition is just fabulous. And I hope you get to spend more time in the space before it concludes. Also, very proud to introduce interdisciplinary artist extraordinaire Dan Boyd, who regularly reinterprets European perspectives of newer Australian histories, and whose work is held in collections in the National History Museum London, the National Gallery of Australia, the Tasmanian Museum and Art Gallery, the National Gallery of Victoria, the Art Gallery of New South Wales, as well as numerous private collections in Australia. Can we just give him a round of applause to welcome him? Thank you. Similarly, I'm very happy to have recently met Michael Aird, Director of Anthropology, Museums, School of Social Science, University of Queensland, historian, anthropologist, curator, and photographer, who will open up his section of the conversation by means of absolute abundance of experience with dealings with numerous Euro museums and their collections. Welcome, Michael Aird. So there'll be many images that evoke conversation tonight, so please do feel free to raise your hand to involve yourself in this conversation. Museum Director Angela Goddard is in the audience with a microphone at the ready. So I will be asking a few questions first, and I will indicate when the time is right to basically start asking questions with Angela. But before I do, I would like to remind you that although this is a casual and informal discussion, I would like all to be respectful of the speaker that is speaking at any particular time. And let's please keep room focused. Bathrooms are outside to the right, past security, and then right again. And please, can we have phones on silent because this is recording? Okay, so I'll begin with a question for Daniel. Can you please tell us about yourself as an artist and then talk about your work here in our two lines?
Well, I grew up in Cairns. I was born in Cairns. I grew up there when I was 19, and then I moved to Canberra to study art at the Australian National University. I guess while I was at university, I kind of lived quite a sheltered life. My mother was born at Yarrabah in a mission. So a lot of the knowledge or historical events that happened, it didn't really come to me because they were told not to. They were told that they weren't allowed to share knowledge. And they were punished if they did. So it was like a cultural practice and language and all that was lost with the church, the Anglican Church in Yarrabah. And so when I went to university, I had all these questions about history and how, like, where I was positioned in society and what my place was. I began looking at science was a big part of that because of Sir Joseph Banks' involvement in the Endeavour voyage. And in 2011, I was asked to apply for a residency at the Natural History Museum in London, and I was chosen. So basically, I went to the museum to study their collection, and they wanted me to kind of focus on the first Fleet collection, which is a collection of watercolors and drawings that were made by a couple of artists. So it was this kind of colonial legacy. There were three of us. One, there was a person from China, and there was a person from India. And basically, it was these countries that had huge collections within this institution. And
can I just ask a question there? Were they focusing on other collections, or were they focusing on what you were?
Oh, no, they focused on material from India and material from China. And so, I stood there kind of, the legacy of the museum and its relationship to us here in Australia. And so, I wanted to kind of extend that research into the human remains unit at the British Museum.
How did you feel?
They kind of knew what I was going to do. They put me there for a reason. I mentioned in my proposal that it would be something that I was interested in looking at. And for me, it was very difficult to kind of go there and engage with this collection of human remains, all of the complexities that are associated with these humans that are there in their collection. And so I just kind of felt like I was given this opportunity to kind of share my experience within that institution. The Natural History Museum has become a key place for a lot of the collections across the UK. So places like Pitt Rivers Museum, the Royal College of Surgeons, the Wellcome Trust. These are all places that acquired or had come into the human remains from around the world. And it was all related to Darwin, Charles Darwin, and eugenics, and amateur science. People would keep skulls in their house to be part of their vanitas.
Mm-hmm.
So it was the skulls came into these human remains came into the museum through all these different kind of paths, these different pathways. So while I was there, I wanted to kind of so I went to the human remains unit. They were transferring their collection into these new conservation break boxes. So they had if you can imagine. Like a box like that. The lid came off. There was a tray that kind of sat inside the box, and then both ends of the box have the option to kind of fold down. So you can slide a tray out of the box, and it means that you're not handling the skull. So it's a very simple gesture to change the box to make it operate, but you're not handling someone's remains, so you're not touching them.
So these boxes.
No, so the
are yours.
These, this is yeah. So the so with my work at the museum, my research, I created an installation. So it was basically to create an installation at the museum in the Images of Nature Gallery. And I think it's maybe at the beginning, it's a shot of it.
Yeah.
And it's, I kind of felt like they were discarding a part of their legacy. It was a, you know, it seems crazy, but like the archive or like a box, it carries, you know, all of this association as well. It becomes such a loaded object. I didn't want to allow them to kind of forget their legacy or their history and where they've come from. And so I presented the boxes in the cabinet with on the left hand side with the old boxes, and then I gave the boxes back to the museum so that they had to keep the boxes in the collection. The curator and I spoke with them and we had an agreement, but I think they reneged on their agreement. So these are the last two boxes that I brought with me from Natural History Museum.
Can you go back a second? What happened with this agreement? Like, was it?
It was a verbal agreement. And I kind of left it in the hands of the curator there, and then she was let go from her position as temporary art curator at the museum. And I don't know if I had anything to do with that, but there's different sides to how people feel about their collection. You know, it's the people who are from the old guard, and then you have people who want progress and change.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it can very easily be lost in within a huge machine.
Some of your experiences in this arena, if you would both of your experience, what's the general reason of it for why these items remain in the museum collection? Surely there is no special scientific reason why they are still being held. So why can't they just come back?
I think from my experience of looking at the 300 plus remains that I was in charge of at the Queen's Museum, that, you know, most of them have been there for close to 100 years. And I think with one exception, not only one of those skulls had actually been accurately scientifically measured and studied, the rest had literally sat there for 100 years in case they would be useful one day. And basically they haven't achieved I mean, I guess you can talk to archaeologists and a very small number of Indigenous people that will disagree and say that some good science comes out of it, but I think it's very few. And I remember I was attended a World Archaeological Congress in 1989 in South Dakota, and that was the first time World Archaeological Congress was a new archaeological overarching body that were the first to really just start the discussion about human remains and the return of them, and the conference was actually titled the Archaeological Ethics and the Treatment of the Dead. And as a result of that conference, there was 50 sort of Indigenous people there, as well as many hard-nosed scientists, and there were some real differences in opinions of people, basically some archaeologists saying, we need to draw a line in the sand. If we give Indigenous people something, well, they'll keep coming back wanting more. And but the result was the Vermilion Accord, a document called the Vermilion Accord, which the following year in 1990 was the guiding document for the NACPRA, the Native American Grave Goods and Repatriation Act. So that it was 2000 that the first, 1990, that was 8 years, so 1990 was the first, that you wouldn't think it would be, the United States would be leading with a policy that actually guides the return of human remains. So prior to 1990, there was, in the 1980s, there was only the beginning, I guess, both from an Australian point of view and a national, international Indigenous point of view. It was only then in the 1980s that Indigenous people even had the power and the confidence to walk into institutions and challenge scientists and institutions why are they keeping this stuff. And then returning, starting from the 1990s on, but it's still incredibly slow.
Daniel, you made a few comments at the start, and then you said, when I went to university, and there was like a big leap there, and I was thinking, did you have some mentors, or were you a serious young man who did a lot of reading and knew what you wanted to do? I mean, it's not very many young people who can follow a path unless someone's perhaps assisted them or had some sort of aspiration for them. Can you tell us a little bit about the years before you went to university?
I had dreams of playing in the NBA. I played semi-professional basketball in Cairns, I was pushing myself intellectually in basketball. I got to university and I didn't know anyone. Quite a shy guy. I spent all my time in the library, and I came across books by Gordon Bennett, Fiona Foley, Judy, Destiny Deacon, and Vernon came to Cambridge School of Art to an exhibition that he was in at the Drill Hall Art Gallery there. And so these networks, they were kind of, they were starting. I could see that there were other people that had been before me, because I didn't know about art really. I was kind of, I was given a very So it was like I felt like I had, they gave me strength to be able to do what I do. And they gave me the confidence to be able to ask these questions, because I had these questions.
Okay. So
what
about this work here? Is it resolved, do you think? Or is this the beginning of something? I mean, the residency was in 2011, but the year of award is 2017.
Yeah.
Is that it?
Well, I must say, it kind of, through, to me the boxes were never really an artwork. Like, they were, I placed them in an exhibition in Sydney at Rosen Oxley Gallery to give context to a painting of Joseph Banks that was in there. So there was the exhibition was called Floating Forest, and it was about breadfruit being taken to Jamaica to feed the slaves there from Tahiti. And it came from Joseph Banks. You know, he was like, in Tahiti they have this staple food, and you can it grows really fast, it's plentiful, and so they. That's what the Mutiny on the Bounty was about. The Bounty was transferring breadfruit to Jamaica. And it's a part of a bigger thing. Like all of my, it's kind of like, all of my works relate to the others. They're all relative. And the boxes were there to kind of, there was also a small painting that I did of the chief that killed the cook in Hawaii. So there was this thing about, you know, remains and like a play on that whole thing, you know, cook being killed in Hawaii and his remains being given back to the crew.
Yeah.
And so it's like this, it's just a part of
the relation of all your work.
Yeah, so it relates to I'm kind of always building on things or ideas and expanding on things. And they're already really complex. You know, like the relationships that they have between the world works.
Yeah. And the work is just so heavily researched. So Michael, how do you feel in your position about the work that you deal with, the remains, the museums that you deal with? How do you feel about artists making major statements about these tragedies that are playing out within these museums? I personally think that it's, thank goodness for artists.
Yeah. I think that's exactly what I was going to say. And I think it's great that there's this next generation of young Indigenous artists keep doing the same thing.
Yeah,
actually, rather than just blindly attacking institutions, actually spending time with them, visiting them, trying to understand, and then of course then you know, academically, you know, critiquing and questioning and criticising, but doing it in a, you know, through art, through a process.
Yeah.
And and again, you know, like I said, it's, you know, it was only in the 1980s that for the first time, you know, only a small number of Aboriginal people had the confidence to even walk into these institutions and challenge the institutions on any issue at all. And then now we've got this great army of Indigenous artists, you know, so many are doing it. So I have to continually congratulate artists like Daniel that are doing this work. And I think as a museum worker, I mean, it is an incredible experience, you know, going to places like the British Museum. And I remember, you know, particularly the first, I think, two times I went to the British Museum, I couldn't help but basically saying, on one hand, say, yes, I support museums in principle, but the British Museum's got too much stuff. You know, it is a colonial tour. You know, this is what they've conquered half the world and stolen all this stuff, and here it all is. trail climbing kangaroo. And that's one of the first, when Lumholt spent time in 1870s, that's it, yeah. That's one of the actual five specimens that Carl Lumholt's collected in the 1870s in the Burnett River region. And the reason I got to see, let's see, there was five collected, two have gone missing, three are in the University Museum in Oslo, in Norway. And 1989, I was invited to speak at the Sami Museum Conference in Northern Norway. And coincidentally, I've been working in Townsville with various elders at that time. And one elder said to me, he said, when you go to Norway, can you go to the University Museum in Oslo and look for those tree climbing kangaroos that Lumholt's collected? And this is, you know, this is 1999. And he's talking about an event that happened like 130 years earlier, as if it happened yesterday. And then another cousin of this old guy, and these two cousins don't speak to each other at all, they haven't spoken to each other for several years, they'd had a fight. And the other guy said, yeah, when you go to Oslo, can you go to the University Museum and look for this? And then I did that, so I took the photo of the curator and I took the photo of the building, you can see that there as well. I came back and I gave one of them a photo of the building, of the objects, and the first elder said, wow, so that's the building where they live. And then he goes, so that's the fellow that looks after them.
Yeah.
And then the next day, one saw the other, his cousin, and he said the exact same thing. That's the fellow, that's the building where they live. So it really drove home to me that he's these old Aboriginal people with a genuine connection to objects in a museum on the other side of the world that have been there for 125 years. So it's this. So it's reasons like that where I have to support the need from institutions that care for objects.
Yeah.
But of course there's a line when you're talking human remains and other things.
Yes.
I got to hold a piece of Mars and a piece of the moon at the same time.
She's the senior curator of senior curator of Africa, Americas, Asia, and the and Oceania, and the Pacific. So she's Tasmanian Aboriginal woman. She's had a long association with museums. She was head of the Aboriginal collection at the Victoria Museum back in the 1990s. And that's her. She took me that photo there. She's holding one of three boomerangs that Kowali Sandy or King Sandy of Brisbane sold to a collector at Sandgate in 1876. And they've been sitting in the Paisley Museum ever since. One shilling each. And he also bought these local baskets, shields, from his time he spent at both Sandgate and Cunningham's Gap. And also three ornaments belonging to Kowali Sandy's wife are also in the collection, just out of the picture.
What were they?
What
were those objects?
They were ornaments, two were sort of pendants and one was a head ornament. So sort of, it is incredible, you know, seeing objects like that. These images here are held in a small museum in the Orkney Islands in the very north of Scotland. And they're potentially connected to Captain Cook because Stromness, the town in the Orkney Islands, was actually the first point of where the crew of the Captain Cook's crew after his death in Hawaii landed in the UK. And they had two boats. Well, they actually put it out in the paper and auctioned off everything that was on the ship because I guess the sailors knew they were both Captain Cook was dead and they were basically out of work, so they held an auction to sell off everything. The ship's china, everything got sold off. But the problem is these were obviously some local guy probably bought a boomerang at auction and then took it home and then it's, you know, years, 200 years later, the actual proof that it came from one of Cook's ships is lost. And so it's just these incredible stories of these objects sitting on the other side of the world.
Well, that's also one of the reasons like these claims take so long is because you have to make sure that these people are from where they say they're from. to the wrong place, and you know, there's it's a very difficult thing. So it has to be right. It has to be an assurance of that this individual is from this particular place. So that's why, you know, there's like all this research. When I was at the museum they had about 14 different claims from around the world at that time, and they were looking at a couple of years, maybe two to four years before they got cleared. And there's 300 or something, 300 Indigenous Australians at the Natural History Museum. So it's,
how many Indigenous workers?
Well, actually, when I was at the Natural History Museum, they did bring, they brought someone from the Torres Strait, and they brought someone from the Northern Territory across to work with the Human Remains Unit, specifically. And they were engaged in repatriating human remains to the Torres Strait. And they were just kind of, you know, they were moving in the right direction. They were kind of trying to understand the protocols that needed to be in place so that they could start to engage different communities or...
And hands on objects?
I don't... I wasn't around. I mean, I had when I was there, I gave the museum a list of all of my ancestry, where they're from and their groups, and they came back to me with a particular skull that was a possible match, but like I was saying, it's like it was taken from a burial ground west of Brisbane. And that's all the information that they have. And you go into a room by yourself with the person who's showing you the human remain, and you don't touch the spot. It's just for you to view it. It had numbers inscribed on the skull. It had stickers on it. So it's
numbers on the museum.
Numbers drawn onto the skull. That was very difficult. That particular thing. But I knew that if I didn't do it, then who after me, or how many people after me are going to have an opportunity to be in the same position that I was in?
Yes.
And so I took it upon myself to kind of do that and deal with the collection and make it and to put it in the public, in front of the public, because they don't understand the amount of material that is in the collection. And so they had the cabinet. The installation was there for a year in the British Museum. And so they are moving in the right direction. I was part of a conference at King's College in London about museums wanting to change how they deal with the collections. Like I said earlier on, in the installation there, or maybe there's some images there of art that my artworks that I made, and they're in black frames. The frames are the lid and the tray from the new Natural History Museum
deposits.
I wanted to kind of touch on that, the shift in the museum, because I understand that not that long ago there was nothing was happening. And so, it was a way for me to share my stories or my experience with the so yeah, it's like the box was, it kind of ch- it, it kind
I think it's a difference between, yeah, people having been told something and on reading
normalising labels.
Yeah, and then just reading labels and being told something to actually just people looking at the objects and thinking about the stories behind them, questioning who made it, who owned, well, who owned it, who owned these human these human remains belong to people that have aged, that have descendants. And, and I mean I think it's one of the sad things about the big, classic museums in the UK and Europe. They've all, many of them all have to have their great Egyptian rooms, just like the British Museum and many other smaller ones. And you just think, I'm uncomfortable walking through saying these poor people didn't want to end up here. It's not,
They used to bring mummies back from Egypt. And this is how some of the remains ended up in the Naturalist Museum. And they would have shows in the street, and you'd pay money to see a mummy being unwrapped. And when they were finished, they were just like a pile of bones on the ground, so they would just scoop them up into a box and give them to the museum. It's funny how all these the objects, how they move. Associations through their kind of journey throughout time and space. Yeah. They touch people, they engage people in these different ways. And, that's what I find really interesting about objects and museums is the way things operate in different contexts. And that's kind of, that's why.
What about the housing? What are these rooms like with all of these bodies? The actual storage, how is it? Is it air conditioned? Is it quality control?
Yeah, they're state of the art facility that nothing insurance in. Because UK's keeping place for a lot of rooms. They amalgamated all of these collections from all around the UK. I didn't get to see where they were housed. I just saw the. I did ask some of them, but it's all state of the art archive.
Yeah. Okay. Audience questions?
I can reframe my question after your beautiful conversation. I'm just thinking about the keeping and disappearing and. I was initially interested in how you feel the remains might best be returned, and thinking about events with Mungo and remains returned into the land, and also to family and descendants. But then it's also kind of interesting the remains that are kept, and maybe I'm also thinking, is it Flinders whose body was recently rediscovered amongst this mass grave, and that there's something sad about the loneliness of that body, that you don't hear from his descendants, or maybe we've yet to hear from them, but it's lovely to think of people speaking for their ancestors and thinking about how their remains should be respected and returned to country.
There are a lot of different groups of Indigenous people in Australia, and culturally they're not the same, and so they deal with their dead differently. So it depends where you're from, how you deal with the repatriation. So it's a very specific thing to somewhere.
And the provenancing is the big issue. How do you, of course, the modern sort of through native title and different government bureaucracies expect each Aboriginal person to belong to a defined group. But Daniel's, mentioned this back to the time, so you need, I guess, a real understanding of how collectors worked at that time, how lazy, you know, and how incompetent, how mistakes happened in the curatorial process over 100 plus years. And, you know, so how do you deal with an Aboriginal community that stretches from Brisbane to Woomera, say? You know, so it's this never-ending lot, you know, lot of questions on how, you know, somebody has to take responsibility. And it's just one of those things, it's hard to get people to agree on things.
Well, just quickly, you have like amateur people who were just helping out in the museum, and they were like with these boxes, you know, they were transferring things into boxes or writing numbers, documenting all this stuff, and they couldn't even spell. Like, there's like a spelling mistake on one of those boxes, and you know, it's so it was it's very easy. It's very easy for information to get lost in this, in the trajectory of this person.
Sorry, I don't mean to interrupt, but this is a question primarily for Michael, but really for both of you. It's about, I guess, Michael, you mentioned a couple of times different sort of hard lines. You said, you know, in 1989, there were a bunch of argument scientists were saying we have to draw a line in the sand because of, you know, Indigenous people ask for this, you know, human remains, then they'll ask for more and more. And it seems that, you know, the maybe would answer that, yes, they would, and that is probably, they should be asking for more and more. And then a little bit later, you refer to, like, of course, there's a line when it comes to human remains, that human remains, of course, should not be, you know, disnutriated, like kept isolated in museums. So where actually is that line? Are museums capable of having a clear perspective of that line, like beyond this, it's okay to keep these things, but everything else should be repatriated? Or is there, or should there be a sort of global movement towards repatriation generally? Like, to what degree, where does that process stop, and where can it stop?
Well, I think there shouldn't be a line. Yeah, there shouldn't be any line drawn in the sand, because I think Indigenous people should be allowed to walk into a museum and discuss the return of anything that they think is important. Whether it gets returned is another, you know, that's when processes have to come into play, because, I mean, I've heard some crazy ideas of, one person wanting to return every single rainforest shield from every institution in the world to be stored in a renovated service or petrol station in North Queensland, in an area that floods with horrible, you know, storage conditions. So, and how do you get every single person from the rainforest region in Cairns to agree on trusting every single rainforest shield going to one community-owned organisation? So, you know, so there is, you know, there's never-ending layers of debates about, yes, some institutions don't do the right thing, but yes, these institutions are well-resourced to care for things. They still will exist in 100 years' time, and then you could, an object may be returned and buried, rightfully so, because it's associated with a burial or, you know, ceremony. And other incredibly, you know, important items could end up under somebody's bed and never seen again, or something else could end up supposedly returned to a community and then auctioned off, you know, an auction house, and someone keeps the money. So there's no, yeah, to me, certainly no line in the sand. It's just a matter of, again, I congratulate the incredible role that artists do of raising these issues, and it should just be a never-ending discussion between Indigenous people and institutions, if that is the question.
I just wanted to raise a point with part of the issue now with returning some of the material is that, like, as you've mentioned, it's not well labelled and it's really difficult. But this is kind of a catch-22 that communities have put in now, that museums are saying, okay, well, if we take DNA, then we may be able to return it. And of course, a lot of communities don't want for that to happen. And I went into some of these institutions as an archaeologist, and I came out with a rather different perspective. I came out furious, and I don't think that they, a lot of them do have good intentions. And I was told directly that while they're publicly in negotiation to return material, they have absolutely no intention of letting that happen. And I think that part of the respect that you're seeing in not touching the objects comes from they don't want them contaminated because they want to take DNA.
In the beginning I kind of I touched on it, but there are two different sides to a big institution like the museum. They didn't want me to look at, like, there were people in the museum that did not want me to do what I was doing there. And the curator, she lost her job because of what I did. And I pushed a lot of people, I pushed a lot of buttons, and I made them kind of think about what these objects, these objects and these people are doing in the museum. And so there's one person in charge of the human remains unit at the Natural History Museum, and she has a couple of people come from the paleontology department or somewhere else to help her out. They're not putting any money at all into the human remains unit. They're stalling it. That's what they're doing. And it's very easy to see that that's what they're doing.
So being, actually inviting Indigenous people into an institution, that's labour intensive. Some of these institutions aren't, they don't have the resources or aren't directing it in that. And then of course, again, back to the issue of provenance, it can take a massive job narrowing down where something could be. You've got, you could have, a large percentage of these items, if you're lucky, you have labels on them like Australia or Queensland or North Queensland or Western Queensland. That really doesn't leave you much of a clue where they come from. So it's a massive, archival research undertaking to try and narrow down only a small number of those items to something more specific.
Can I just add to that also? Just a comment on how you're feeling infuriated and quite upset and angry about that. My comment is, how do you think we feel as Aboriginal people when this is actually happening to our families that we have no control over? And I really feel that we've been pushed to the point where we almost have no choice to skill ourselves because of this anger and this frustration, to the point where we have, and we work in museums, and Dan is working in museums as well, but working using his voice as an artist to create change, and that's collectively what we're doing.
It's just a comment that I've seen some, video documentaries about the Tasmanian Aboriginal community who had some remains who were coming back from the British Museum, and there's a beautiful video sort of talking about that whole process of people from the community coming back and receiving the remains and then taking them back to Tasmania. And recently at the memorial conference down in Melbourne, and the Edgar Norman Parker was showing images and videos of a Kimberley community which also had remains sent back to their community from the European Museum. So I think it is happening, but it really depends on the goodwill of the people in the institutions. And as we all know, that goodwill is not everywhere, but it is for some people. And the same with curators in museums. We're lucky we've got Gay as a Black Insider. She's fantastic, and there are so many other people around, and so you just have to have a rhythm in and work with those people because they're your way in to our collections.
Mm. Yeah, well said, thanks, Julie. Yes.
I guess that a lot of the talk's been about the repatriation of physical remains, and that comes to problems which are cited by museums about provenance, as you've been talking about, and also where as well that's really about the kinds of material that have been repatriated from various art clubs and museums around the place.
Often, you know, a lot of work with photographs. And it is amazing, you know, how these photographs are so widely distributed, you know, particularly 1800s, early 1900s photos have been widely distributed. And I guess it's completely different to human remains. I mean, a good digital copy, and, you know, really, it's not, to me, it's not that important where the original is kept, especially when there's some maybe commercially produced images, and there's multiple copies around. It's just a matter of finding them. And it's more important quite often getting the information that's attached and putting into context, you know, why a photo was collected.
Do you find though that most museums will give you a front and back copy?
Yeah.
But I have to admit, it was only last Monday I was in the Royal Anthropological Institute in London, and I'm looking at a photo of a beautiful old man, and you know, I guess I had to deal with something quite disturbing. It really is one of the most disturbing things I've seen after many years of work in museums. Here I am looking at this photo of this man. He's very much alive and looks happy and healthy. And the note on the back discusses the fact that on the that he died on the 25th of September of whatever year, and on the 26th he arrived at the dissecting room. So that's a pretty clear indication of what happened to him after he died. So it's pretty real, you know.
Yeah. Can I just comment? So I used to run a museum, the Linden Museum in Yarrabah, and there are times when it's quiet and there are no visitors over the hill. So I would flick through the records, beautifully written early 1900. Records, just looking for my family, looking for my family history, because this museum, which is a Queensland museum, people visit this museum, mainly locals, to find, to discover their family history. People are usually as far as Mornington Island or Townsville will come to the Manly Museum in Yarrabah. And again, stories about death, and dates, and children, and heartbreaking stories are just so matter-of-factly written on cards, and just Aboriginal people with given names and a number. So, I agree with Judy. It's a process with dealing with, I guess, allies in museums around the world, but also becoming one of them. You know, becoming someone who can represent a museum in a positive way. So I think we've got one more question. Yeah.
Yeah. Just to touch on what Michael was talking about. A second ago. Last year I was in South Africa with Uncle Major Morty Sumner, and we're sitting down having a cup of tea in Bloemfontein, and he was talking about repatriation and the years of work him and a few other people have done in terms of repatriation of human remains. And they were visiting, it was either, you'd have to ask him or Uncle Bob whether, Uncle Bob was there as well, sitting in Oxford University or Cambridge, and the director of the museum there was staring at Uncle Bob the whole time they were talking, and at the end of the lunch he leaned over to Uncle Bob Weatherall and he said, this is only in early 2000s, late 90s, and he leaned over and said, Bob, when you die, can I have your remains? This is, you know, so it sort of gives me this sinking feeling in your stomach that this is the director of one of the world's best institutions in terms of how they view, how Aboriginal people are viewed now. You know, like still now in this day and age, people will be asked for the remains. Uncle Mookie jumped the table with a boomerang and went to throw at this bloke, and Uncle Mook had to pull him back, and there was swear words being thrown around. So it's just, they were there for a really important reason. But yeah, I thought I'd just add on to what Michael was talking about earlier. Maybe, and ask the question, have you, in the years that all three of you have worked in your discipline, have you come across any sort of, not as, you know, that's a pretty extreme thing to happen, but micro, you know, just that underlying sentiment of maybe
continued disrespect.
Yes, yeah, yeah.
Well, I think, I was just going to say, I mean, you know, yeah, that's pretty shocking for so recent. But Gay, you know, Scarthorpe, she's, you know, she's got letters that were written in relation to her grandmother's grandmother in Tasmania, where the scientist was saying, I don't think her husband will be agreeable for us securing her remains when she dies. So it's, you know, so that's, you know, there's her great-great-grandmother, the scientist, you know, is hell-bent on getting her human remains when she dies. While she's still alive, he's discussing it. So that's, for someone like Gay that works in museums, has dealt with this for many years, it sort of brings home how real it is. And these stories have to come out, and that's why, again, the importance of artists telling these stories and making people think about it.
So I have a question for both of you, and I'm mindful of the time, just one question. If you could, and I guess it does, it's a role from what your question, your statement was just now, thinking of next generations, knowing what's happening now, what do you think will happen, say, in the next 20 years? How will this affect our next, say, two generations if something is not dramatically changed with the way that, let's say, bodies are held or treated?
Well, I think you can't. I mean, well, I think we're going to be okay. I think a lot more of our young people are going to university. I think that's where it begins. Like, well, you know, they become independent. Well, I did anyway, and I guess if I can plant a seed, you know, with someone at school, and you know, primary school or high school, or I have students coming up to me in the street all the time,
okay.
Yeah, and that's the whole, you know, I have people ask me, you know, what's the greatest thing that you've achieved. And it was having people at university, at high school, at primary school engage with my work. That was the most important thing. I've been in some really amazing exhibitions around the world, and that still is the most important thing to me. Is about kind of passing on what I know to the next generation.
Yeah, it kind of exemplifies culture. It's a transference of, I guess, information. Yeah.
Yeah, well, I mean, well, that's the kind of reason I started making work, because I wasn't allowed to receive this information.
Yeah.
You know, so it was about, you know, if I couldn't have it, then I would.
So I think I agree with Daniel, you know, the next generation, I mean the growing generation of Aboriginal university graduates is an absolute key. You know, that is changing the landscape. And they're
do this incredibly important work of holding these institutions to account, of making things visible, which are otherwise hidden away in dusty old boxes and shelves. And I think that that kind of, I suppose for me, that's just the incredible fact of these two little boxes that sit on a plinth in this exhibition, where we can all encounter these items and think about scale, I suppose, is one of the things that I think is this is where skulls fit. This is where all of our skulls could fit. These ancestors are scattered throughout the world, and it's the work in the arena of contemporary art, which I think is this special kind of context in which we can have these discussions and confront these histories and these legacies and look at them. So everybody, if you'd like to join me, thank you. I just wanted to remind you all that we've got another discussion next week on Wednesday, I think the 6th of February, with Shannon again in discussion with Carol McGregor, who's here in the audience, relating to Carol's work in the exhibition and the comics of Carol's practice. So please, all of you, come back next week. And also, if you brought your glasses in and they're empty now, if you could just bring them up to the stage and leave them with us as you're leaving. Thanks, everyone, for coming.